And we are back with a news gang.
Tuko pamoja.
Yes.
Bado tuko pamoja kwa news gang.
You know, in my village there is usually I used to keep, I still keep pigeons, by the way, and there is something called a peregrine falcon that basically swoops and takes the pigeon, and every time it does that, it will just land somewhere near in an open field or something. So if you see it do that and you just not sure where it has actually landed, you like throw a stone in there and then it will emerge from somewhere and go and probably leave the pigeon alone. And this looks to me a little bit like what's been going on here, Linus, where people are seemingly in some kind of fishing expedition, like let's see what we'll find out here, because it does look to me like there are too many unanswered questions in this so-called assassination plot, that it almost looks like maybe some people were suspecting something was happening, and then they decided, let's throw in all these things, a letter, whatever it is, and all the allegations and everything. Let's see what comes out. That's a theory that I've heard out there.
That's true. I mean, it is a political thing to do that. Just throw the proverbial red herring and see what can come out of that. And I think we should pity the DCI.
Yeah.
They find themselves in a very difficult position. Because supposed, as we all assume here, all this will just be mere political tactics that went wrong. How will they look? How will the DCI look? Because you heard, and you said it in the intro earlier, that you know, the DCI is now alleged to be a member of the Kieleweke. This kind of characterization. And if you're talking of the Itumbi and the online propaganda team, they are very, very good, very efficient, very effective in coming up with these narratives and making them stick. They can run it round the online platforms. Itumbi, we know very well, has been very good as a creator of hashtags. I remember when we were in NTV and we carried exclusive stories about the Afia House scandal. And we went very hard, we went out very hard on corruption and called it System ya Majambazi, borrowing it from a song where, you know, everybody is corrupt.
The lawyer is, Majambazi.
You know, the system.
Yeah. Yeah. And then System ya Facts came up.
Yes.
He responded with System ya Facts.
Yes. Yeah.
And you know, he loaded it with activities. You know, whatever government function there'll be, he'll throw in System ya Facts, and dismissing the media as a propaganda tool, and saying that this is not what the facts are all about. So DCI should prepare for a backlash, especially if this doesn't go to the bottom and establish criminal liability as per Section 66 of the Penal Code. If they don't establish that indeed Dennis Itumbi is culpable and should go to jail for 2 years, then it'll be big trouble and bad image for DCI.
Francis, there's something Yvonne said at the start, that the court case, whatever happens to it, might really not resolve this matter, especially to the extent that it's a political, more than really even what's going on in the courts. Or at least what we've seen is that there is a very deliberate attempt to make sure it really is not the court thing.
A political problem cannot be solved legally. It's a political problem looking for a political solution. And even if you were to take very many people to court, you will not arrive at that political solution. Maybe the solution is in guys having an honest discussion and asking each other what is happening. And if the relationship is over, it's possible for two people to sit down and say, by the way, this thing is not working. That is one option. Or two, this is not working. Why is it not working? How do we fix it? But legal solutions applied on political problems is a mismatch, in my opinion. And every so often you hear this soundbite by James Orengo in the Senate some years back, that there's a way a revolution eats its
and
own governments children
eat
and
its
government
own.
Their own eats its own people. And this also brings back the village wisdom once again, that when a hyena wants to eat its children, it accuses them of smelling like goats. Goats, yeah? And
you and Yvonne must come from the same
village. Absolutely. This is village wisdom, unfortunately, fortunately, is spread across.
Thank you.
So a lot of these things are going to happen. You will see quite a number of people being arrested for one reason or the other. And you see, the government has a repertoire of I would call
too
what?
Many tricks in that
too many tricks
in their
and
heart.
Also
grab it, you know, just
keep pulling them out one after
everyone has a closet, and so the government has the key,
right?
Every so often when something happens, they're able to open
and your skeletons come tumbling out,
a skeleton or two, and they can be able to pin it on you. So a lot of these things are going to happen, and don't be surprised when you see a number of arrests. And also from the deputy president's side, don't be surprised when you see now a few things being unleashed in terms of scandals. Mm-hmm. You'll be told some documents will start.
Isn't
that what the Kileweke people were beginning to say? Hey, like, can this gentleman record a statement?
Precisely. And these guys know each other. You know, when the relationship was working, they had each other's back. So now, when it is not working, it is an opportunity to unleash a few things. You remember the Grand Coalition government, the Kibaki Raila team?
Hey.
Ilikuwa ni kusetiana. Huyu akiweka tunaweka. Akiachilia tunaachilia.
Until they reached an equilibrium.
Ilo mtu alikuwa ameka yake yote.
You will see a lot of
enough that on both sides, so they kind of moved on.
Something Yvonne said before the break has me thinking about, you said about the fickleness of our political parties, how they're all vehicles for the elections, and come the next one, we drop it off and get another one. And I won't be surprised if that happens before 2022. And that worries me about democracy in this country, because if parties had roots, people would fight more for them to make sure that they still have them as they go forward. Look at the Democratic Party. That party was formed, I think, in 1828 in the United States, and it's still there. The Conservative, I think, 1830 or 1834, and they're still there. They have deep, deep roots. So people are really passionate about their parties and the fact that they want them to survive and keep prospering. But we don't have that in this country. We very easily just want to discard to Atani Nayato to Endelem, but it served its purpose, and that really worries
can
me.
We need to remember the words of David Murathe when all these things started, about the deputy president in 2022. He threw something there and said, there'll be new formations. And I think we should take it that for that as a fact, because that is how we have operated. There is no party since KANU that has ever succeeded itself. By the way, even Jubilee was an alliance in the first term and was a party in 2013. The National Rainbow Coalition in 2002 for 5 years, and then after that, the Grand Coalition. The Grand Coalition. So we don't have a history of a ruling party that stays and succeeds itself through election, and even less through a presidency, you know, the end of two terms,
and going
to the next. So for a fact, in 2022, we'll have new parties.
Joe. Where are the party members of Jubilee? I mean, forget the MPs, eh? You know, the card-carrying members, you know, like in KANU, where are they to sort of hold their party leaders to account? Wako wapi hawa
wanachama kaza wanakadi? The only visitor in Jerusalem who actually has a party card,
right.
You know,
like
KANU
ones who had the life card for KANU. Then you are stamped every
people
year.
People belong to parties in this country based on where they come from. So if in whichever part of the country you come from, ODM,
but do you remember
ODM
they recruited party members?
So let me tell you
before. I know I'm being idealistic.
They said they did.
Yes, they said. Where are those people to say, hey, things are going wrong in our party?
Kasarani, who's there?
Who's there? Actually, who are those people who are at Kasarani when they have these
every county? What I'm saying, like
in my village,
they were recruited. They did the job for which they were recruited.
Let me just illustrate this in my village very briefly. In my village, there is a perennial candidate. You know, he's never won an election, but he was running for councillor. He was running for the MCA position, but he's never won an election. And he always introduces himself as the chairman of all opposition parties in that location.
Clearly, so that he is deserves the title.
Yeah, everything. Yeah, but you see what happens, why I think what Linus is saying is quite interesting,
yeah.
That usually because there is no ideological basis upon which people come together to belong to a certain party, they usually have this idea of the election, either getting someone out or trying to win power.
Right.
And if they are fortunate enough to win power, then there is no glue that keeps them together after the election. That's why you see there are all these midterm fallouts that happen almost after every election. So after 2 years or so, you start seeing the center beginning to give way, and before you know it, there is a whole new political constellations coming together so that people can now begin to prepare for the next election. And that is it's totally unsurprising, actually,
right.
That Jubilee has started to crumble in that way, and new formations beginning to.
If one trace back to the last 5 general elections, look at the parties that have won.
Yeah. Mm.
Is there any political party that has won twice, 2 general elections in quick succession?
Well, a girl can only hope. I was trying to be hopeful.
Even flip the coin, even the opposition, since 1997, 2002, and thereabout, because political parties are not structured correctly in our country, and for the simple reason that, as Jamila said, special purpose vehicles. But there are 2 tweets I want to read here. One is by Frederick Okango. He says, the perceived division in Jubilee is artificial. The narrative is driven in such a way that it should accommodate an outsider and isolate an insider to divert the public attention from real issues. Then there's a guy from... I don't want to say Jamila's backyard.
Okay.
He's called Adan Duko. He's saying, there's a Somali song that goes, a house with a broken wall cannot save you from cold. Jubilee Tuko Pamoja slogan seems to be crumbling and it won't save us Kenyans.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Interesting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But as you speak about crumbling, there's also another house, or is it houses, that... are also crumbling, quote-unquote, because of the supremacy contest, the National Assembly and the Senate. We've seen the National Assembly threaten the Senate with a court matter, and the Senate, on the other hand, saying we'll take you to court because of passing a few laws that we have not been involved in. And interestingly, yesterday, the House suspended sittings basically to discuss this issue about who is bigger than who. And reminded me of an interview I did with Peter Munya 2 weeks ago. And here is what he had to say about parliament and parliamentarians.
Utoto.
You know, let us be mature. Utoto mwingi. Siasa ya Kenya iko na utoto mwingi. Na watoto wamejaa hiyo bunge. Wanahitajika wale wako huko, wana uwezo wa kuwa persuade, waelewe vile wamepewa majukumu makubwa, wawaeleze zaidi. Kwa sababu sasa mimi nimekuwa accused ya kuwa. Si niko na haki ya kusema sijapanga hiyo. Nimekosea nani? Nikisema hiyo naambiwa sasa nitatolewa, nitafanywa impeachment, you nini? Empty threats.
Very well. We will not go into the alleged impeachment motion because it never happened. But the first part of that discussion, I don't want to say I agree with Munya or I don't, but what we have witnessed in the last few weeks would lead somebody to say maybe Munya has a point.
I was actually very upset. Sorry, Ijo, something you said about them suspending any other business that could have been discussed in the house yesterday. Kujua ubabe ni nani mkubwa zaidi ya mwingine na mamlaka zaidi ya mwingine. I was thinking how that time could have been spent in otherwise discussing issues that are more important to the Kenya. I think personally for me it doesn't matter who is more superior to the other, so long as what they were put there to do is done. And I think Linus alluded to this. He said he blames the 2010 constitution for the mess we are seeing. And we sometimes keep talking about kupunguza mzigo and the fact that you have our wage bill is going through the roof and you have too many leaders who sit in our parliaments and that. And you ask ourselves, do we really need all of them? Do we really need to have all those members of parliament and all those senators? I'm not sure. But for me, what really upset me was the fact that a very valuable parliamentary time was spent on trying to decide nani mkubwa zaidi ya mwingine. And that's really unfortunate.
Yeah, and you talk about the issues with the constitution that Linus mentioned. And it was very clear from the start, after the 2013 general election, that they completely disagreed. Remember, their very first tiff was in 2013 when the Senate Committee on Legal Affairs and Human Rights proposed at least 25 changes mm-hmm. to the Constitution, seeking to give more powers to the Senate. They wanted to triple the amount of money going to the counties. They wanted the Senate designated as the upper house, amongst a number of others. In fact, they also wanted exclusive jurisdiction to vet state officers, like members of independent commissions, CSs, and that sort of thing. They were likening this to what happens in Rwanda, where the Supreme, the Senate approves judges of the Supreme Court. And all of this started when what happened? The National Assembly, during that division of revenue, said that $210 billion would go to the counties. The Senate wanted $258. The President went ahead and signed that bill into law. The Senate felt that they had been excluded mm-hmm. and they had been ignored. They went to the Supreme Court, got the Supreme Court advisory opinion, which in fact agreed with them that they should be involved in all of that. And so it's all been all about, you know, who decides on whether a law is touching on counties or not. And then again, all of that, even in 2018, when Lusaka and Muturi clashed again, Muturi said the Senate was actually talking, originating bills that were not meant to be in mm-hmm. their purview. When Ledama Olekina introduced the Retirement Benefits Amendment Bill, Muturi said that was a money bill and it should be there. So these fights, and perhaps the lack of clarity, I don't know, in the Constitution since 2013 but today.
I think, Gashuri, if you look at this thing, it speaks to a bigger problem. In fact, what Monya was talking about, even about impeachment and all of these things, mm-hmm. there's a certain whimsical way in which things seem to happen in Parliament that is quite concerning. Because, you see, the Constitution that we passed created a problem in the sense that we have the reality of what it says and what is perceived by most people as best practice around mm-hmm. the world. So in many jurisdictions, you find that the Senate is clearly, without a doubt, what is called the upper house. Basically, they mm-hmm. have the last word on mm-hmm. a number of things. But here, the truth of the matter is, if you were to go by the letter and I suppose the spirit of the Constitution, the National Assembly is indeed mm-hmm. More powerful than the Senate, and that is how the Constitution designed it to be. And I guess the reason perhaps could be the fact that when that Constitution was being discussed, a majority of those people who were there, who were sort of representing Parliament, were in the National Assembly. So there's a sense in which they made sure they secured the powers of the National Assembly and sort of created this house that
only
was
to end up in the Senate,
more of a token. Right. Yeah, but a lot of them went to the National Assembly, and the Senate sort of became a secondary option for a number of them later. Mm. But many of them had the mindset that this National Assembly needs to be powerful because mm-hmm. we are going to come here. And they were actually members of the National Assembly at the time. So we have a situation where now Parliament is in this situation where there is what everybody knows the Senate does out there in the mm-hmm. world, and then there is what this Senate of in ours here. Is supposed to do. Because just one major important thing, this the National Assembly concerns itself with matters of the nation. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The county the Senate is restricted in a very large way to counties, except when you're talking about things of impeachment of a president and his deputy and that.
Which
but
rarely
how many
happened.
Times would that ever happen, mm-hmm. if ever, in this country? So you find that we have a situation that either we have to face it and say, hey, we want the Senate to be that powerful
house.
Thing and go ahead and amend our Constitution to do that, or we just shut up and follow the Constitution the way it is.
And before Linus weighs in, something Yvonne said about the two speakers of the houses clashing on an issue. The one time that I can remember, like in the past few months, that they were tuko pamoja was when you're discussing about the 250,000 shillings house allowance that all members of parliament in the Senate walijipatia, and that was the cause of a hullabaloo with the SRC that has still not mm-hmm. been resolved. But at that point, because it was benefiting them, tulikuwa wote pamoja, a united house.
But Linus, look at it this
interesting.
Way. Who cares which house is bigger than the other? Isn't it about Kenyans to decide by the Senate is doing a good job, or the National Assembly is doing a good
job. Quality of legislation.
Based on the quality of legislations, how well they can do oversight, how well they can represent the people who elected them. And then when I listened to the discussions in the Senate and the National Assembly, that seems to escape.
Look, it's a statement that we are not a country that really respects institutions. We are not about institutions. We are about ego. In fact, some of those MPs, actually the members of the National Assembly and members of the Senate, sometimes speak of that contest as though in physical terms, like they can have a wrestling much at the presence of parliament. That is how they see it. They see it in terms of a very egotistic point of view. But I want to go to a tweet that somebody sent. He's obviously operating in pseudonyms because he calls himself or herself Apache Helicopter. He makes a very valid point here, and I want to speak to it. Kenyans wanted young leaders. This is where young leaders got us. We need maturity in government. Let us face it.
And by the way, Fred Obachi Machoka is asking, do MPs get sitting allowance for discussing who between the National Assembly and the Senate is superior?
Oh, yes.
Of course. It's a session. Yeah, imagine.
It's a session. Even if you just sign in and you come.
No matter what you discuss.
In fact, yesterday morning there was a lack of quorum.
Even if you discuss handbags.
Yesterday morning there was a lack of quorum before like the discussion came
out. Unlike that letter, this is a case where what you discuss doesn't matter.
Let me just finish, Francis. I was making a point about this young leadership issue. And I want to say the Kenyan leadership landscape is suffering the plumbing equivalent of an airlock. If you know about plumbing and airlocks, meaning the system can't function well until that airlock is addressed. 2013 came, and I remember the campaign was about digital versus
analog.
Analog.
Ageism.
Yeah, ageism. Huh? Where a young team completely succeeded to paint certain politicians as too old. And what is the result? The result is so many experienced politicians out of the mainstream. We don't benefit from, for example, the likes of Martha Karua. Martha Karua should either be in Senate, Governor, or National Assembly. Musalia Mudavadi is out there. Peter Kenneth. There are so many of those politicians that are just, and it's a generation, it's a certain bracket of politicians that was skipped in that election of 2013. That airlock is in the system. That is the immaturity you see. You listen to even whatever level of government these days. You can't compare it with the previous ones. Because
but
experience.
Actually, I think we have some of those sound bites from the previous generation of leadership.
Do we?
Yes, Robert.
It's an integral part of development planning. It is an essential part for the reason that you cannot hope to plan other forms of production if you cannot plan the production of the main resource, the human beings. We view it as an aspect of human freedom. In the same way as we give people education so as to open wider horizons for them in the world, the same way that you provide a farmer with greater knowledge about the seed, about fertility of the soil, about climate, about rotation of crops.
There's hope that change there will be. But this change cannot be in terms of pious resolutions and words. It's got to be translated into action. For it is only then that we shall know that there is a definite departure from the past, and that America intends to take on a new role, to stand for the things which she preaches.
Lina Zejo, I want to throw this to you.
Wow. By the way, Kibaki audio should have been 1968.
68, 69.
Yeah.
In Kakamega.
Yes.
And that is Thomas Mboya. Joseph Mboya. Mm.
Yeah.
By the way, he died at 39. Yeah. So
50 years ago tomorrow.
Yes.
You see, there's a question that probably you two can help us answer. When you look at the past parliaments and the current parliament, what would you say about the quality of legislation, quality of debates? And as you answer that, there's a gentleman called Steve Oyoko on Twitter. He says, the constitution well defines the roles of the Senate and the National Assembly. Why should our leaders then spend much time fighting on who's superior? I feel these leaders are led by their greed and ego.
I totally agree. And I think that is where our problem is. You see, if the for example, why don't we have MCAs trying to do something that the National Assembly is doing? Why don't we have the judiciary also? Everybody has been given their lanes by the Constitution. So it does not matter what tradition, legal or political tradition says out there. If this is what our is found within the four corners of our constitution. Can we just stick by that and stop wasting national time and money, as we have clearly seen? But I think on the question of the quality of leadership, you cannot help but miss the kind of debates that happened,
the kind of speeches
in Parliament,
that we've just
the seventh
watched.
Parliament, the eighth Parliament, that sort of thing, where actually every time it did not even matter what the conversation was all about. It was really just about the quality, the clarity of thinking that you'd see in some of those people. If you talk about the likes of Mokisa Kitui when they were in that house, people like George Anyona when they were in that house, Martin Shikuku during
Peter
his time,
Ringo.
The guy would actually stop you in your tracks and quote some standing order that probably you never even heard about, and even the speaker sometimes will be startled, like, wow, okay, I had not thought about it that way. Those were people who really understood leadership for what it was, and they applied their mind. Right now you get the sense that there's a certain hollowness that has gripped our Houses of Parliament, so much so that we can actually discuss a lady's handbag for 10 minutes.
Joe, you're talking about hollowness, Linus, and it reminds me of two incidents. One that happened today in Molo, where a public baraza to discuss increased sale of and consumption of illicit brew was disrupted by the Member of Parliament for Molo, Kuria Kimani, who came in drunk. And I think we can see some of the images there. And what was upsetting to the villagers was the fact
he's
that it was clear that he was drunk, not his normal self. And they were so bitter because they said, we elected this guy with the hope and prayer that he would represent us, but he comes and messes up a
meeting.
They woke
up at 3.
What happened to that recall thing, Francis?
Well, it was made very difficult.
Yes.
It's very, very difficult to recall a member of parliament. Obviously, that at that time, it was to insulate that procedure from frivolous recall attempts. But at the same time, it also made it very, very difficult for the electorate to deal with their errant members of parliament. But Linus, the quality of debates in the House, but granted, there are a number of very, very, very good parliamentarians. They may be in the minority, but we cannot fall for that fallacy of generalization and say maybe the House, the 12th Parliament is not very good, but there are quite a number of MPs who know their job quite well, but still there are questions.
Yes, and I think I want to say that leadership is created by circumstances. The circumstances of the 60s, the 50s and 70s were completely different. We were struggling, for example, first of all, for liberation. So it was very, very clear that you know, for you to emerge, you have to be clear in as far as African rights are concerned, in as far as statehood creation is concerned. So you have this higher cause that you rally around. That is what created the Tom Boyers, Jomo Kenyattas, the good leaders that we had in the 60s. And they had the presence of mind to interact with the rest of the world. I don't know who today, for example, will interact comfortably in the current leadership setup with the Pan-African context or the global issues. What if the Cold War happened right now? Who is that we can rely on? We don't have such people. Now, Joe did mention the likes of Mokisa Kitui and a very, very good parliament that came about between 92, I think, and all the way to 2002. That was a very good period. But again, these were leaders that were produced by years of fighting a single party system, fighting the KANU regime, fighting for more space. And you know, that put them through some struggles. What has produced the current leaders? The guy drinking and jumping over a fence over there. I mean, the motivation for leadership has completely mutated. And even the population also must be must take responsibility here, the voters.
True.
What are they looking for? Some of them are looking for ethnic warriors, somebody they think, oh, will speak so loudly and strongly about this and that tribe. Even the aspirations of the population have changed, and that is hurting leadership. It's producing very, very useless people who talk different things. The other day, somebody made xenophobic remarks.
Yes.
People are cheering. They are cheering. Do you understand what that means? Do you understand how many Kenyans are out there working in jobs in foreign countries, very, very good positions. How many Kenyans are working in Tanzania, for example? How many Kenyans are working in Uganda? Those are things that we don't understand. So we are operating in small spaces like Luthuli Avenue and forget that we are part of a very complex and increasingly globalized environment. I think two things. We need leaders who aspire to become leaders for good reasons, and two, a population that also
has six better,
higher aspirations.
Okay, higher aspirations, Gashuri. Mm-hmm. And Linus, thank you. Someone here is saying that it's electorate, electorate, electorate. We have to think about who we are queuing at 3 a.m. for to elect, because we have to elect to wakilisha miaka mitano, and we need to elect them for the right reasons. Okay. Ni wakati wa kukamilisha kipindi cha News Gang.